I try to find different ways through the mechanics of photography, the aesthetics, light, color of black and white, to find ways that are going to have the most impact on the viewer. It's my job, my responsibility, to give you a truthful representation of what I am seeing. Authentication now, probably more than ever, is essential. And I think we have to just look at Ukraine. People said it's fake. People said I've set it up. People say these people aren't dying. The captions have been changed. So there must be a way to authenticate what photographers are seeing, and then to be able to use that with other information to hold people accountable. I had already been working as a freelance photographer documenting kind of big news events for a couple of years. And I read about this possibility that this place, Yugoslavia, might start breaking apart and might do so violently. Some colleagues were told that fighting had started in a town called Bijeljina. The town was just over the border from Serbia. By April 2nd, a convoy came in, led by a warlord known as Arkan. Arkan had announced upon his arrival that he was there to cleanse the town of quote-unquote Muslim fundamentalists. At that point, he was very famous. He was an assassin for Tito. He had escaped from jail in Europe. During the Croatian War, I was able to take a portrait of him where he held up a baby tiger. His unit was called the Tigers. Turned out that he liked that a lot. So when I saw him again, I reminded him that I had taken this photograph, and I asked if I could go off with one of his units, and he sent me off with one group. So I thought that this work would be the photographic evidence that would prove to the world, like, this is what's going to happen unless you do something, and unless you do something quickly. We were going through town street by street, so this is just one of the places where they said they were engaging with Muslim troops, but I don't recall any incoming fire, but there certainly was outgoing fire. We eventually arrived at a mosque. They took down the Islamic flag. They asked me to take a photograph of them posing with the Islamic flag, which I did. And after a short period of time, I heard some shouting, and I walked outside of the mosque. And all of a sudden, they brought out a man and his wife. The husband fell to the ground. The wife obviously was distraught, screaming. I don't know who pulled the trigger, that it was somebody, one of the soldiers from behind of where I was standing. Even though they were still yelling at me not to take any photographs, for myself, it was obvious that I was witnessing a war crime. I realized that I needed to make sure that there was some document of what was happening.
He was also one of the first photojournalists to cover the wars in the Balkans. His new book, Blood and Honey, a Balkan War Journal, collects some of his most powerful images from his 10 years there. I am pleased to have him here at this table for the first time. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
This is a powerful series of photographs.
These photographs appeared in Time magazine and other magazines around the world. There was a bit of an outcry, and the story disappeared.
And what does that tell you?
It tells me that in that case, the Serbian authorities played the PR card very well, and they understood that the world attention on this war was very limited, and people didn't want to get involved, even when they were seeing images like this.
I felt that even though I had had the photographs of Khaymeta trying to save her husband, I still didn't have absolute proof, visual proof, to prove that the Tigers were actually there on the ground with their victims. My goal was really just to get a photograph of the soldiers walking past the victims. And as I sort of framed the lens and framed as several soldiers came in, one soldier, kind of a brash young guy who I'd seen earlier in the hospital, sunglasses on his head, cigarette in his hand, kind of came into the frame along with two other soldiers and brought his foot back. I remember being relatively scared taking the photograph, making sure that, you know, my hands didn't tremble too much, that the photograph would be out of focus or be affected by that. What happened next, because this is a regular camera, so the shutter closes and everything goes black. So I wasn't sure exactly what I had. There were posters made with the photograph and the slogan, "Come and fight for your Muslim brethren." So it was used immediately as propaganda. Look what's happening to us, come and help us.
Garde takozvanih Arkanovih Tigrova.
Town had already been split.
This is the picture that you took.
This is one of the pictures that I took them during that trip.
Kada se sjetite tih strašnih ratnih slika u Bosni i Hercegovini, koje su vam najsvježije?
One of the announcers came on television and said, "I've just seen these photographs from Bijeljina. I can tell you now the war in Bosnia has started."
These things seem framed so well. I mean, is that simply editing? Or?
Nothing is cropped. These are all exactly what I saw in the picture, and nothing is computer altered or anything like that.
No, I know it would be that.
That's just the way that I'm seeing things.
I don't know all the different ways the photograph has been misused. I know that there are hundreds and hundreds, or if not thousands, of comments and various postings over the years in social media, kind of Serb, Russian on one side and Muslim, Western sometimes on the other side, and you see the argument back and forth. And this is, without question, you know, where we are in the world. The danger of miscaptioning, the danger of photographs that are not authenticated, or people don't know whether to believe them or not. Again, using Ukraine as a great example, where the Russians said, "Those bodies were not there when we left." And we are in a very, very dangerous place where people can just deny. Yeah, it's a little dark. More. If we as a community of visual journalists lose the trust of our audience, they just say like, "Oh, that's been photoshopped," the tragedy becomes the stories of these people are not believed. I mean, it's all really all about impact. I don't want people to just flip the page, swipe to the next picture, etc. I want you to stop, understand, absorb, have an emotional reaction to the image, and then it's up to you what the next step is. What do you do next? Because once we lose that, once we lose that ability to communicate with our audience, the world will lose the ability to learn about each other and learn about the way things work.
Wow.